Good evening, everyone. I welcome you to our webinar today. I am Yashima Jain, and I'll be moderating your session for today. Now, today is going to be an interactive session with our technical resource group members. We have TRGs from five expertise areas, which is water, whole building energy simulation, HVAC and controls and operations, lean construction and structural detailing, and renewable energy. And we hope to have a lot of engagement with the participants and the TRG members. So feel free to send in your questions in the Q&A window. Before we begin, I would like to thank the support. I would like to acknowledge the support of the Department of Science and Technology and the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. And I would also like to acknowledge the support of the sponsors and affiliates of Solar Decathlon India. Today we have the following technical resource group members on board. So for water, we have Abhimanyu Dhariwal, Rasika Apte, and Pooja Munde. For whole building simulation, we have Sanchi Pathela and Dhanashri Mankar. For lean construction and structural detailing, we have Samvedna Jadhav and Manish Kumar Sharma. For renewable energy, we have Ankit Chauhan and Pradeep Padamnath. And finally, for HVAC controls and operations, we have Sahil Priyadarshi and Puneet Kumar Batra. So a few of them have not joined yet, but we do have one person from each expertise group, and I think we can get started. So I'll stop sharing my screen so that we can see all of our TRG members. And great, so we already have questions coming in. So the first question is a water related question. And the question is, how do we decide the capacity of a water storage tank? So Rasika, would you like to take that up?
Yeah, sure, Yashima. Hello.
Yeah. Hi, Rasika.
Hi.
We're able to hear you. Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Rasika, so the question is...
Feel free to introduce yourself briefly if you want.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hello, sir. This is architect Rasika Apte. I have recently finished a master's in environmental architecture and started a consultancy on my own. I'm associated with Solar Decathlon in this year as in the capacity of a TRG member, and I'm glad to be a part of it. Now going to the question, I think they are asking if how to decide the capacity of the water tank. I think, yes, the first thing they should be looking at is the number of persons that are there. If it is a residential project, then the total count of people should be there. Or if a commercial project, then they should consider the visitors as well as employees. And based on that, they will be able to arrive at the capacity of the water tank, depending upon how much water that they are using every day. I think they have to consider 1.5 days of supply for a residential apartment projects at least, and also of another fire tank they should consider, but that is a separate from the domestic water tank. So a number of people should be the first thing that will help them in calculating the capacity.
Can I ask a follow-up question related to that to Rasika or Pooja, or who's the third person?
It's Abhimanyu. He's not there yet. Yeah.
Rasika, Pooja, I think maybe it might also be good to talk about the fact that since we're making this a net zero water building, sort of water sufficient building, that's what the participants are going to do. They are going to try and store as much water as possible that they can gather from the rooftop, etc. And yes, maybe and storage tanks always take up space as well as cost. So what is the thought process involved in optimizing the size of the tank as opposed to just going for the as much storage as possible?
So I think the first thing what they can do is they can focus on reduction, water reduction. That is where they'll reduce the demand. That will that would be for the occupants. But if they are going for irrigation also, there also they need to think about various systems that will help in reducing the demand and thinking of species which will use less water. And same goes for HVAC if they are trying to use that. So once if they reduce the demand, then the next thing is looking at the different sources. So if they want to take from municipal or if they have chance to harvest rainwater. And the thing, the other could be if they can recycle the gray water. So they can focus on these things and then they can size the storage. And while doing that, they can also check the efficiency of the system because that is important and the seasonal variation. So two things should be taken into account while doing this. I think these two. And while placing or sizing the storage, one thing is important that placing the storage also. You need to think if the space is available or not on your site. If it is small scale, then it will be difficult to have it on site, like above the ground. In that case, they can think of underground. But if they have space available on site, above ground, then they can put it above ground because it becomes easy for maintenance. I think, Rasika, would you like to add to that?
Yes, I think the point you said about seasonal variation is very important. They should do like a monthly calculation of how much water they will be needing for HVAC and other uses. Because HVAC will majorly depend on seasonal variation and also how much water they are able to harvest. And then they can take it further to arrive at the water tank sizes.
Right. Thank you, Pooja and Rasika. We'll move on to the next question. So this is a question for lean construction. Considering our project context, we want to involve the local materials and workforce in the construction process. So going with local, how can we ensure that our project building is also highly scalable at the same time? So Samvedna, would you like to take that up? Hello. Hi, Samvedna, you're on mute. Okay.
Let's come back to this question again.
You want me to repeat the question?
No, we'll come back to this question.
Let's do that. Sure. Next question. How do we arrive at monthly seasonal slash usage factor percentage for irrigation and cooling tower usage? Pooja?
Yeah.
Would you like to answer the irrigation side of the question? Yeah.
So for irrigation, you can consider whenever there's a rainfall, that time the usage factor would be less. And during the summer months, the factor would be higher. Or even during the winter months when there is no availability of rainwater. So not rainwater, but if you want to consider for this irrigation, then the factor would be highest. Like during some summer months, it could go up to 50%. And during rainy season, it could be more less. For example, it could be 20%. And during winter, around Jan, Feb, that it could go up to 100%. So now, depending on their climate zone, they can decide this factor.
So, Pooja, would you recommend that they talk to a landscape architect or somebody to get some specific numbers for their regions?
Yes, I would recommend them to do that because they have a clarity regarding the species and they can, and even the amount of water that would be required for that kind of species annually. So it would be better to get in touch with them.
Right. Thanks, Pooja. So Sahil, we also have been asked about the cooling tower water usage. Would you like to take that up?
Sure, Yashima. Hi guys. So for cooling tower usage, what I would suggest you is to look at the range and approach. of the cooling tower. So you will be able to identify the effectiveness of cooling tower, and based on that, you can go backwards to your capacity, which is basically the tonnage requirement in the building, and using that, you can work out like what would be the water consumption that will be required for cooling towers. So that's the approach that I would suggest you to go forward.
Sahil, how do they take out results from the simulation model to be able to understand the, you know, the cooling usage or cooling tower usage for a month, say, for example?
So they can model it. I'm not sure what software is being used by
Design Builder.
So in Design Builder, you can work it out by extracting the looking at the summary report that gets generated after the simulation gets over, and navigate through the sizing of the system, and there you get into the component. And once you arrive at the cooling tower, there you can see that whatever efficiency or effectiveness that you have selected, that based on that value, you will get that this particular cooling tower, that particular component will have certain value associated with it. And based on that, go back to your tonnage capacity, which will already be, if it's on auto size, it will be reflected there. If you have entered it manually, then also you'll be knowing that what's the tonnage capacity. And based on that, you can use a formula and you can work it out, what's the value. So that's the approach through simulation. But yeah, if you want to calculate it manually, then also you just need to know the tonnage capacity and the effectiveness of the cooling tower. So that's it. And in effectiveness, I would like to reiterate that please do look at range and approach of cooling tower. So don't look at just effectiveness value. Range and approach are important.
Didn't you do your Bachelor of Engineering project on this?
Yeah.
Lucky for you, you got this question.
All right. We'll move to the next question then. Sanchi, this one is for you. So if we use a furnace as a source of space heating, do we include it in our energy calculations? If yes, how?
Okay. So first I would like to understand as to for the Indian climate zones, mostly we provide heating only for the colder climate. And if you're using furnace as one of the space heating approaches, so it could be like either through hot water or steam. So that could be considered. And the component that you will consider, like it will be a space heating component that should be included in your energy calculation. So that's what I could suggest. Dhanashree, you would like to add something?
Yes, the space heating factor can be considered, and the output files can be taken from that if you are modeling the same. And
okay, I think frozen. Yeah, mm-hmm. Dhanashree.
The last part got cut out.
Hello. So yes, like Sanchi said, the hot water system, you can take it from either from like in Indian climate, you don't need heating. But if you are using that, then you could really model it. And you can get the output results from the simulation.
I think the question is about using a furnace, which is a natural gas or an oil furnace, to provide space heating. And the question is, you know, how do we include it in the energy calculations, which means how would you do it in the simulations? Any ideas? Anyone? Sanchi, not a model one.
I would like to just mention a way around of this. One should know what type of furnace is it, whether it's oil-based, gas-fired, or wood-based. What's the source that's being used in this furnace? So that's first. And once that's already decided, the second step would be like, what's the capacity that you're trying to cater through it? So for example, for wood-based, you can convert it to calories, and then whatever the size you have defined, you can do a manual calculation quickly and you can determine the output of it. So through that way, through that manual calculation, you'll be able to find out that what's the amount of heat that will get generated through this furnace. And that can be used. So once you have arrived to that value, let's say in kilowatts, so that kilowatt can be directly entered into the energy simulation as an output using a separate meter. So that's one of the way through which you can input it into the energy simulation. However, in certain simulation software like in eQuest, you do get an option, or in Energy Plus as well, you do get an option to model furnaces directly. So that's another approach that you can follow. Whichever is convenient for you. In manual calculation, it might become a bit tedious, but it might lead to a correct value that you may directly enter into the energy simulation software.
Great answer.
Yep. Thanks, Sahil. Thanks, Anchi and Dhanashree. We'll move on to the next question. So we have a question related to water again. So how to use the lake available at site for water sink / rainwater harvesting and microclimate control of the project? Pooja, Rasika?
Hello.
Yes, Rasika.
Yes, if there is a water body present on site, and if the team is planning to use it as water sink or some other uses, I think they should first check with the existing flora and fauna of the lake and whether it is legally or other biological repercussions might be there if they use it as a water sink. Or even if they are using it to discharge of the treated water, still they should check whether the existing flora and fauna will be able to sustain with that. And depending upon the type of climate that the site is located in, a water body can be positively used to affect the microclimate of the site. That strategies they can find out depending upon the climate zone that they are located in.
Right. Pooja, would you like to add something?
Yeah, I think what Rasika had said regarding the water quality, so that is the major point that needs to be considered. Like if they are discharging this rainwater, that needs to be filtered and the quality should be maintained as per the flora and fauna. And if they want to use this lake to improve the microclimate, they need to check their wind direction also. And the climate zone, as she said, rightly said, that you need to check whether it is feasible to allow that humidity inside your building or not. So depending on your climate zone, you need to check whether it is feasible or not, and in which months it is possible to take advantage of that lake.
Right. Thank you, Pooja, and thank you, Rasika. Next question.
Just one thing.
So how to...
Sorry. Modeling a lake body and the microclimate impact of that on the building is going to be really tough. And I'm just going to ask Sanchi and Dhanashree or anybody else for that matter, on the TRG if they've ever done something like this.
No, we have never modeled a water body as such for simulations.
Yeah, just modeled neighboring buildings.
While I was in power plant, when developing power plant, so we have this, like, it's not directly model of a water body, but we have these ash pits. We have a huge ash pond where we deposit the ash. We did consider the amount of water required to put in the ash there, so that at the time when water evaporates. But it was not using any high-tech software. It was a very normal thermodynamic calculation, which we did. So which we arrive at how much water evaporates and how it affects the amount of moisture in the air. So that's a kind of, ideally it gets added to our emissions. I mean, when we, in the plant emissions, we have CO2, O2, and we also have H2O. We also have water vapor as one of our emissions. So somehow all the, that because it's a man-made tank and it's caused because of the activity of the power plant, it's got added to the emissions. So those kind of modeling we do, and we also somehow calculate, I mean, if we have a weather model. So if we put the amount of moisture vapor coming out in that particular area, it adds to the artificial enclosed or artificial number. So there's a dust number, there's a particulate SPM number, which gets modified with the water vapor. But I don't think that's very suitable or it's relevant for this for such projects. But a simple calculation, thermodynamic balance calculation, would tell you what is the amount of moisture, water vapor you're losing if a mass balance is required.
Right. Thanks, Pradeep. We'll take the next question now. The next question is related to renewable energy, and it's which type of large span structure is feasible in which PV panels can be installed and have accessibility. So Pradeep, would you like to answer that?
Okay, so yes. I'm not sure this falls under renewable energy. I guess it falls more under construction, or I would say architecture, because it says large span structure. Now, ideally large span structures are defined as those structures. I mean, a lot of architects here, please drop in if I'm wrong. We usually have 12 meters or exceeding 10 or 12 meters of length of roof. These are basically roof structures. They can also be a support structure. They can also be an external facade. They can be anything. If they are supposed, let's assume one case that they are a roof structure, then they can be either with supporting pillars or they can be pillarless as well, because their support can come from the surrounding regions. Now, there are some beautiful examples of buildings which have this kind of large span roof. Mostly if you go to airports, most of the airports, they have this large span roof, and they can be made very easily, such as to incorporate solar PV. And most of these roofs are accessible from the top. It's not that they're not accessible. Yes, unless you go for, even if you go to Charles de Gaulle Airport, so they have this roof structure, they have a lot of glass there. The glass is used to allow the sunlight to come in so that they minimize the lighting cost. But even the glass are being cleaned, so everything is accessible. I don't see a reason why a long structure may not be accessible for installation of PV and maintenance. However, if you're going to install a PV on a large structure, the load calculation has to be done accordingly. You cannot first build a large structure and then decide to add PV to it. That will damage the load. So you have to first do load calculation. If you're deciding to have a large structure, you have to calculate the load based on it. And if you want to install a solar PV, it will be best to put a fixed system. Tracking system on large structures won't look good. It won't be acceptable the harmony of the architecture. Basically, the architecture will call the shots in this, not the PV engineers. The architecture will design how it looks like, and then it has to mold through it. So basically, a fixed system would be good enough, slightly slanted so that the water runs off, and that should do the trick, and it should be easily accessible. I don't see any problem or issues in accessibility. However, this is a more question of design rather than engineering, I would say so.
Right. Thank you, Pradeep. Next question is a simulation related question. So Sanchi and Dhanashri, how to develop a model for a natural ventilation system?
Okay.
So just as a background, our participants have design builder, are using design builder. So if you could respond with respect to that.
Okay. So I think first so it depends on the city where your building is going to be located. So I think you should study the climate of the city on the basis of the IMAC model, the Indian model for adaptive comfort, and then figure out the number of hours that are comfortable in a year. Now, this will get you a rough idea as to how many hours are comfortable. And so this is one way of doing it. Now, in the energy simulation model, you could model your windows such that they are open during those times. So you could use the maximum advantage of natural ventilation. And also the other way around is you are also putting set points in your building. So you could have a timer based control as to when the windows are going to open and when they are going to control. Also when, like, if your cooling has been scheduled to a certain set point, so when the outdoor temperature is favorable, cooling will not be consumed during that time. Sahil, you want to add?
Yes, Anchi, after you, please go ahead.
Yeah. So so I think a rough study of IMAC is required to understand the number of comfort hours as per your climate zone. And then we can, as per the set point and the outdoor temperatures, we can figure out as to when the windows can open and to what extent. So that's how you can try it out in Design Builder.
Right. Sahil, would you like to add?
Yeah, so adding to Sanchi's point, if it has to be done on Design Builder, then the best way to do this is to do a CFD run. And if you have an access to computational fluid dynamics, the steps that I would like to suggest you is first you complete the whole building energy simulation of your model. And once you have completed it, but while doing energy simulation, whole building energy simulation, make sure that in outputs you have surface information selected so that it stores the air inflow, air outflow, the temperature across the envelope of your model. So please do make sure that, so that will actually define your boundary conditions for CFD analysis. So once you're done with whole building energy simulation, so go to tools and then import the boundary condition there. Now for importing boundary condition, you have to decide like which part of the day and time you want to do this analysis. Now, for example, usually natural ventilation is preferred during shallow periods. So for example, if a building is located in hot and dry climate, and let's say you have a favorable condition around 15th of March, then what you will select as a boundary condition there is 15th March, and select an appropriate time. And there you have to actually select the hourly data. So what it does is once you import the boundary condition on that particular day, let's say 15th March at let's say 5 p.m. So 5 p.m., whatever the value that you have got from energy simulation, it will pull that. And it will pull that and store it in your CFD model. Now, that acts like a boundary condition for your CFD run. So that is how you will define your boundary conditions for CFD analysis. And once that is done, you can do an external analysis. You can do an internal analysis, phase-wise, zone-wise, floor-wise, however you want to do this. And then understand the pattern, understand the velocity, temperature, everything, both outside and indoors. So that way you will be able to make best assessment for your particular model, and whatever your strategy is, for example, if it's across ventilation, then study, so develop slices across different planes in X, Y, Z axis, and that's how you can see the pattern variation across the zone. So that's the approach I would suggest to go ahead with natural ventilation for simulation on DB. Yes, Prasad sir.
Yes, Prasad.
Yeah, so if the students don't have access to or can't do EFD simulations, what is the approximate way of doing this with just Design Builder? Is there one? Can you talk about that, any one of you?
CFD is possible in Design Builder, right, Sai?
Not in they don't have the model.
But they may not have the access. Okay.
Pradeep, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, I guess in some cases, like a crude approximation will be a airflow. If they have already their model of the house, they can just decide a cross ventilation airflow. They can have a minimum velocity of air with the air properties. I think that can be entered somewhere. And they can have this airflow map from the meteorological data of a certain place, which is available for most of the countries. It's available free, of course. You can have the airflow properties, you can have the wind velocity, average wind velocity at certain heights, and that data is available. So if you're, let's say you can allow, let's say you have at least one cross ventilation across the house, you can have that velocity input as a as additional airflow or air column. That might help you to, you know, to further have at least some approximation related to natural ventilation. Because others, radiation is very difficult to model, even if, because natural ventilation also involves radiation, but at least the airflow can be modeled, I mean, can be put in this way.
Yeah, I think the webinar that we had from Arjun on Design Builder, that was, when was it? It was on Sunday or it was Saturday, right?
Saturday.
January 30th. I believe Arjun actually went through the natural ventilation modeling of the building, or was it PC who did it?
Yes, it was PC Thomas, not Arjun.
So the Sunday webinar had this.
Yes.
So you might want to look into that. Yeah.
So that recording is available on your online learning platform, which is Moodle. So you know you can look at that, and that will be helpful for you. All right, so next, let's move on to the next question. So another energy related question, as we are not air conditioning the building, what should be our energy performance indicator since EPI values don't give the detailed depiction? Sanchi, Dhanashree?
I find it hard to believe that you are not air conditioning your building, whoever is asking this question, because it's difficult to find any climate in India when air conditioning, you can do without air conditioning at all. So can you maybe rewrite that question with a climate zone, a city location, and what you are doing to state, so that we can know whether you're on the right track or not? And then we'll try to take the question again, but meanwhile, Sanchi, please go ahead. No?
Sanchi?
Sorry, sir, I missed that.
So I said, I've asked them to provide some more details so that we can understand the context that they're talking from. And otherwise, you can simply talk about, you know, the EPI number and the fact that if a building is not being air conditioned, how does it actually show up in the results, etc.
Okay. Yeah, so if we get a clarity about the climate zone and the passive strategies that are using, which are helping you to not use air conditioning, that would like give us a better idea to understand the building. And other than, I think they are also asking about the key performance parameters other than EPI. So you could look at the temperature of the spaces in the building to see as to how comfortable is it and why they are not requiring air conditioning during those hours, and temperature and humidity. So I can think of majorly of these factors only. And other than EPI, so like the temperature would also determine the heat gain that is happening in the space due to the envelope, lighting and equipment in the space. So how all of the, and also the people heat gain. So how the sensible and latent heat loads are acting in the space. And then I think we'll understand the air conditioning requirement too. And and then once a building is air conditioned, you could again check the temperature. And also with EPI, you can also compare the, so this is after you provide air conditioning, but then you could also check the tonnage numbers and the comfort hours in the space to see if your building is performing right. So these could be your key performance parameters.
Thanks, Sanchi. So if we get more details about this question, you know, we'll take it up in some time. Meanwhile, we'll move forward to the next question. The next question is, for a multifamily housing project, area available for rooftop solar PV is not sufficing our need. What alternative should we look at, Pradeep?
Well, when we talk about rooftop PV, people lose their imagination, and they think that only rooftop is the area available for PV, which is not the case. Almost every face or every surface of the house can be used for PV. Architects, please don't run towards me to kill me, but that's the fact. Actually, that can be done, and people are doing this now. The few very innovative areas which can be used. Now, I won't just fill it out everything, but I'll just give you some hints. That can be a shade. If you have gone through the seminars, when seminars were going on, the importance of a shade over a window or a kind of canopy could not have been overstressed. It could never be overstressed. It was absolutely made certain that if you want to have passive design, if you want to incorporate passive design in your house, it has to have include a shade or a kind of canopy or a balustrade. These are absolutely perfect places to use solar PV additional to your rooftop, because these are not visible. They have already this overhang, and these can be used to generate extra electricity. Furthermore, if you want to get more innovative, there is always a option of facade, a light shading facade, or additional or extension to the facade, which is now coming up in many buildings, because they come as heat blocker and they also generate electricity. Now, depending on your location, the generation of the facade will not be the best conditions, but then it will always add up to the value. It will also reduce your heat load. It will be cooling load in some case. So it will reduce the amount of energy consumption of the house. So it's a win-win situation. So you have to get imaginative. Rooftop PV doesn't only mean rooftop. Almost every face of the house can be used for generating electricity as well as reducing the electric consumption. So when you are building, it's not only about generating as much as you can. It's also reducing the consumption and then optimizing these two. One more case you have, or one more lever that you have in your hand, is efficiency. When you have, apart all, like if all these things still limit your area available, then go for the highest efficiency panel. Go for the highest efficiency panel, which will maximize your energy generation. That's also one of the tools that you have. But obviously, high efficiency comes at high cost. That's obviously the case. So you have to get innovative. You have to think how to apply this on your house. But obviously, only rooftop PV doesn't only mean on the rooftop. It means other places as well. You have to think how to apply it. You have to be innovative. And that's what this is for. You have to think, put in a...
Right. Thanks, Pradeep. Next question we'll take around water. So is recharging the ground with recycled water, which is treated to tertiary level, permitted, especially in Gujarat, to be more specific? So Pooja, Rasika?
Recharging the ground with the treated water is permitted at many places, but it depends on, basically depends on the groundwater table at that particular site. So I would suggest the team to look into the local regulations if they have any, and also the local data if they can find regarding the available groundwater table at the site, or if there are any surveys done, then they can get the data from there also. If the groundwater table is very high, then many times it is not recommended to recharge the, to send more water into the recharge pits. So in that case, they can explore another option. But local, these regulations vary from place to place. So it is best to check with the local regulations or local data.
Right. Anything you want to add here, Pooja?
I think Rasika has covered that point regarding the local regulations. You need to check whether in Gujarat it is allowed or not.
Right.
And at what level. If that can be done at secondary level also, if that is accepted, then you can go for that instead of going for tertiary, where additional cost is involved. So you can check the quality, water quality standards that are required, and then you can decide.
Right.
One thing I want to add here.
Yes, Prasad.
Yeah, so I think we've defined net zero water in Solar Decathlon India as the amount of water that you consume is something that you should either be able to source through your own collected means on site, or not or, but in addition to that, if you are putting treated water back into the ground, or into the source that you're taking it from, then that is also considered net zero performance. So if you take water from the city and you treat it to the tertiary levels and then put it into the ground, if the local regulations allow it, then that is considered a net zero performance also.
Thanks, Prasad. Another water related question we'll take. So our project division is of community resilience shelter, and our building is supposed to cater the multi-purpose functions of a school and activity center. So in that case, how do we approach our water calculations? Pooja?
Yeah. So I think now you're... two activities are there, like one is school and the other one is activity center. So you must have formed the building program. In that, you can check what are the activities where water will be needed. And then based on the standard values, you can check how much is like how much water is required, like per person per day. And based on that, you can calculate the total consumption. And if you want, you can segregate the working, like you can have two different calculations and check the total consumption later on, because in school, the working hours would be different on the working days. And if it differs for activity center, you can have different days and then calculate them differently and then sum up. I think that can be done.
Right. Rasika, would you like to add here?
Yes, just like Pooja said, the seasonal variation is the key factor here, because schools have holidays for in the summer, during also the winter. And also the schedule of the activity center has to be taken into account before finalizing the water demand.
Right. Thank you. We'll take the next question now. So the next question is a simulation related question. So as we are using Design Builder, which does not tell about artificial lighting, so how do we simulate both natural and artificial lighting and get the results together? Dhanashree?
Yes. So Design Builder does give you an option to input artificial lighting values. Like you can input LPD values in the model and simulate the same. So yes, that's one option. It does give you an artificial lighting option.
Right. Sanji?
Yeah, and I think we also have an option of modeling the daylighting control. That could be switched on. So during when you are achieving the level of illuminance during the daylight hours, the lighting will automatically be switched off and you can see the variation in your lighting consumption.
Right. Thank you, Sanchi and Dhanashri. Next question. Another energy related question. So our site is located in premises which has a district cooling plant within it. So how can we use it and should we take it in our energy needs? Sanchi?
So if there's a district cooling plant, also your building might, the cooling demand of your building could be sufficed from the district cooling plant. And so this district cooling can be modeled in Design Builder. And like it would definitely help you in catering to your air conditioning in the space. That's all I can say. I'm not much aware of how exactly district cooling is modeled in Design Builder.
Right. Sahil, would you like to add here?
No, I think probably if we know what's the demand that they are trying to cater through the district cooling plant, there's an alternative way that they can directly input that tonnage capacity or whatever the size of the system is into the Energy Plus or Design Builder model. So that won't be accurate enough, but I think that would be very close enough to give you an idea, like how the system is going to perform for their building. So that's a way around, basically.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, okay.
Yes.
All right. Okay. I'll take the next question now. Another PV related question. So since Pradeep mentioned that we can consider vertical facade for putting solar panels, can you elaborate in which software and what input should we give for BIPV?
Okay. So the sad part is I'm not a very big software guy. So no, I hardly worked with software. Although in my team, I was overlooking this part, but there were other people working with software. I'm not sure of the software part, but I think BIPV calculation should not be a big deal. In terms of software, you can just use them as a facade with a particular light ratio or a particular heat capacity which they have, which means they can act as a heat or light shade. But I guess there are people here who can give specific answer related to software. But BIPV, but it can be integrated, and there's not. I don't know what you want to get out of the software. Maybe light generation that can be easily simulated. That may not be go through the software. You can easily simulate the light generation from a BIPV depending on the angle and the solar energy generation principles. Apart from that, the temperature and the effect on the conditions on the like light and temperature, I think that might be done by just modeling it as a facade. I guess some other people here who are more expert in the software section, they might have better responses. Please feel free to add.
Yeah, I saw Sahil.
So there are two softwares. Helioscope is an online tool which can be used for including BIPV as an input while designing or sizing the solar PV. And if you want to get into further depth, then PV Sift is another software where this can be considered as an input. Now on Helioscope, I've done it, so I am sure about it. About PVSYST, I've heard about it, I haven't tried. So I will request the team members to please go ahead and explore that option there. Both the softwares are, so Helioscope is free for a month. PVSYST is free to use, but that requires a lot of detailed input to give you.
Right. Thank you, Sahil. We have another air conditioning related question. So the climatic zone of our building is warm and humid. Our project sits in the context of low income rural community with site located in a village in Orissa. The building will primarily function as a school. So due to very tight construction budget, we are trying to avoid air conditioning. So this is a follow, this is a, an explanation to the previous question, which said that they do not have an air conditioning system.
So let me first set the context here. Now that the, you know, it's clear that they are putting it in a rural area where there may not be enough resources, etc. So if you are planning to do a purely passive building, which means that there will be no air conditioning system, but you might have say ceiling fans or something, and you want to get by with that, then all your passive strategies, which includes thermal mass insulation, natural ventilation, ceiling fans, all of those, you should be able to model that to a large extent to show that your building is able to achieve comfort. And let's hope that that works out. If it doesn't, then for the sake of the competition, you need to provide air conditioning systems and calculate the energy use of those air conditioning systems to be able to maintain the comfort. In reality, you may not add those. But for you to be able to understand the amount of energy that will be consumed to provide comfort with all the other things that you're doing in the building for your context, you need to model the air conditioning systems, and that will get reflected in your EPI and in your energy consumption, and then you show it as a net zero energy building. So it is not enough to be able to say, I've done all of these things and my project partner or my clients can no longer afford an air conditioning system, so I don't need any PV system at all because I'm not consuming any energy. That doesn't work. Okay, so that's the overall context under which we are operating here in this competition. Now I'll open the question up to whoever wants to add the technical specifics of this.
Sahil, would you like to add here?
No, Ashima, I'm not very sure about that. No right. Comment from my side.
Ashima, can you repeat the question? I don't think it's in front of us.
All right. I'm looking for that question.
Yeah, I'm seeing it. Maybe I can read it out.
Yeah, sure.
Follow-up of air conditioning question. Climatic zone of our building is warm and humid. Our project sits in the context of low-income and rural community with site located at the village near Puri district of Orissa. The building will primarily function as a school. Due to the very tight construction budget, we are trying to avoid the air conditioning. Okay, so this is the context. We still don't know what the question is. Sorry.
Yeah, I was looking for that question also meanwhile. Okay, not able to find it.
I wonder if the original question was...
It was an EPI related.
What should be our air conditioning performance indicator?
Yes.
EPI values don't give the detailed application. So now take those two together and say that, you know, warm and humid climate, rural area, district, Puri district of Orissa, function as a school. We are not air conditioning building. What should be the energy performance indicator since EPI values don't give the detailed description?
Sahil, Sanchi, Dhanashree.
I'll take it. I think this is a competition rules question more than anything else. So, as I said, if you are able to show that your building functions and is able to provide comfort with all the things that you are doing without doing air conditioning, then your EPI will be a total of the lighting and any other equipment that you use, including ceiling fans, table fans, etc., etc. All of those things and the electricity consumption for that becomes the basis for your EPI. So EPI is still an indicator of your energy performance of the building. If, on the other hand, for the purpose of providing thermal comfort, you need to add air conditioning systems in your model, then the air conditioning energy also becomes part of your EPI.
Right. Thanks, Prasad.
Yeah, and if you want to look at a detailed performance of your building beyond EPI, then like Sanchi was talking about earlier, you can start looking at the temperature values inside the room and see how the building is doing, whether it's getting you the comfort levels or not, etc.
Yep. Thanks, Prasad. Another question we'll take related to water. So I am recharging X liters of water into the ground. Can I later extract X liters water from the ground? Does that comply with the definition of net zero water approach? Pooja?
Yeah, I think what Sir had explained a few minutes back, I think it complies with that. Like if you are taking, from the ground and you are giving it back to the ground, that means it's a net approach.
Right. Rasika, would you like to add?
I agree with Pooja. I think it basically means that we are not disturbing the existing water table, or we are not putting a strain on it or being a burden on it. So I think it should comply with the net zero water requirements.
As long as you treat the water to the tertiary level.
Yes, yes. Right.
And also, I think if you are not using water from any other source, if it's just water from ground, and then you are putting all of them back to the ground, then I think it complies to net zero, right? If you are also taking it from municipality, a part of it, and you're just putting back what you are extracting from ground, then I don't think it complies to net zero, right?
If you're treating it on site and then putting it into the ground, that still counts, Sahil, under net zero, because you're treating it to the level that people can actually use it. You're not putting a strain on the system in a sense. And this is actually explained quite clearly in the self-learning module on water sufficiency. So take a look at it, and and then if you have doubts, then go ahead and contact Pooja or Rasika or any of the other water-related TRG members, and they can have a more detailed discussion with you.
Thanks, Prasad. We'll take a couple of more questions because we've already hit 5 o'clock. Next question is, our project building is meant to give shelter to the community during the disaster of cyclone. Since solar will not be efficient and wind turbines will not be functional during cloudy disaster days, what strategies should we explore to cater the energy needs of occupants? Pradeep?
Okay. See, the thing is, you have to do what you have at hand, right? And since they have already assumed that solar will not be efficient, which is a wrong assumption in itself, I'm not like, see, you have for the resources, you have sun and you have wind, right? Either if you assume is not working, then what are you working with? Then in that case, you may have tertiary sources, you may have also like solar power plants, which you may build at some places which are not disaster prone, and then you can maybe transfer power from there, which is currently happening in most of the places in India. So that's one play. But if you want to have them self-sufficient, if they want to, if you want like off-grid, because I am assuming, let's say you also can assume disruption to the grid, then still you can size the buildings. For example, in that disaster management, you won't need, depending on what you're trying to provide, maybe lighting, basic conditioning, basic thermal conditioning, maybe fans or maybe heat, maybe a few more electric equipments. Solar energy will still suffice. Put panels. There are certain panels now which can even with the overcast condition they generate good amount of energy. So earlier we were operating with panels with around 15%, 16% efficiency. So each panel rating was around only 140, 160 kilowatts. But now 160 watts. But now we have panels of 380 watts available in the market commercially, which are operated at efficiency of 20 to 21%. So solar energy have progressed a lot. So if you have those panels, they will still generate at least 15-16% electricity in a 30 or AM1. If you reduce the irradiance, still generates good amount of electricity, around 100 to 140 watts. Still generates on an overcast condition, which they have results. Like this is experimented, so this is proof results that we have here as well. So it's not a question of they won't generate. Yes, they won't be fully efficient. I agree. But in disaster management, you don't need, I mean, depending on what are you providing, you have to work with the options that you have. This is an engineering solution. So with whatever you have, you have to work it. And to add to it, you can maybe include battery storage. You can include storage that will further boost up your self-sufficiency. But you can't assume that it won't work at all. It's not like totally dark. There will be some light. And as long as there is light, solar panels will generate electricity.
Thanks, Pradeep. Next question. So this is a question that I had taken before as well. So considering our project context, we want to involve local materials and workforce in the construction process. So along with being vocal for local, how can we ensure that our project building is also highly scalable at the same time? So Pradeep, I know that you're also an expert for lean construction and scalability. So can you talk a little bit over here?
Yeah, so what they are saying is, if I get the question right, the question basically says is they are going to involve the local materials and people, but they want to ensure that it is scalable.
Yes. Right?
That's what the question says. I don't see a problem in that, as the material data used is very exiguous. For example, let's say you're using bamboo. Now, their project will not be scalable with the local materials if they use more bamboo than available in the local area. So in order to say that, if they want to have a directly assessment that if they're projectable or not with the help support of local materials, they might have to first do a material analysis that what is the market, what is the availability of the raw materials there. And then perhaps if they use it, or they have to understand that how much material is available for them to use. Lean construction also comes in minimizing the waste and recycling the waste. So on the construction sites, when you apply the principles of lean construction, that also includes is a whole ecosystem. So you minimize the total embodied energy in terms of reducing the energy transfer, using energy involved in transport of the materials in construction. So you choose materials which are low embodied energy, which have low energy for construction, which don't require too much energy for construction, as well as they don't generate a lot of waste. Now, if these materials are available in the local in sufficient quality, in sufficient quantity, I don't see any problem in scalability, as long as you are going for very niche materials which are available in very small quantity. So the scalability is not an issue. The issue is, it may be like, you know, the materials available may not be suitable for your kind of application. So in that case, you have to work around. Again, you have to be innovative. You have to think that the local materials which can go into my product or the solution that you're developing, and what you can absolutely cannot do without. And then go for the next solution. So it's always about minimizing the impact. Sometimes you make a zero impact, that's very good. But sometimes you don't make a zero impact, go to the next best solution. So then go to the next solution. So always have option A, B, and C available. Take the best available material locally, which is abundant, which is also energy, not very intense, if not option B, if not option C. And then this is how you create a library of materials and a library of solutions which you can come up with.
Right. Thank you so much, Pradeep.
But I think the question was not very clear in this. I mean, if this is what they asked, so this is what I can think of. But I'm not sure this was a question who were intent to ask.
Anyone else who would like to add to this question, Prasad?
I wonder if Rasika or Pooja or Dhanashree want to add anything here.
I think Pradeep has answered it aptly.
Yes.
All right. Let's take another question then. Is there any kind of system in Design Builder or any other software which takes the schedule according to the dynamic values that come as a result? For example, fan will be functional only if the operative temperature is between 26 and 30 degrees Celsius or things like that. Sanchi?
So fans, I think they're talking about, I'm not very sure about it.
So your
again,
voice
for
is...
the ceiling fans, you can set a schedule. You have a temperature schedule and the operative temperatures can be set up and...
No, your voice is okay now, Sanchi.
Yeah. So I think they're talking about fans. So you can set up a schedule in Design Builder as to when you want to switch it on. So a temperature schedule can be, operative temperature schedule can be set up between the required temperature range, and the ceiling fans would then switch on automatically as per the schedule applied.
Okay. Dhanashree, would you like to add over here?
Yeah, whatever Sanji said, that we can, input the schedules for fans and the operative temperature. Yeah.
Okay.
And
I should not repeat the question. I just want to make sure we answer.
Yeah. So the question was that, is there any kind of system in Design Builder or any other software which takes the schedule according to the dynamic values that come as a result? For example, fan will be functional only if the operative temperature is between 26 and 30 degrees Celsius or something like that.
Yep. So I think that they answered it nicely.
Yeah. And we'll take one last question for today. So the question is, please guide the team for context and market analysis expectation as our team is struggling with the same. So who would like to go first? I think all of us, all of you over here will be able to answer this question because you all have participated in the competition. So Sahil?
Yeah, this is architect's forte, so they should be one to answer this easily.
Thanks, Pradeep. I'm still thinking through.
Yeah, and Sahil is not an architect.
I'm not an architect. So I'm still thinking through how to put it best. Meanwhile, if someone would want to share their message, please go ahead.
All right. Pooja?
Context and market analysis. So
yes.
Market analysis, I think.
Yashima, you only answer this question.
Yeah.
You. Back to you.
all right. So I think when we talk about context and market analysis, we need to see that where our project is located, how apt is it for that locality. So for example, if it's a school, is the school really required in that locality? What are the education or literacy rate numbers? What do they look like? That is the kind of market analysis that you would do to see how well your project fits in that particular location or locality. Also, I think when it comes to context, you can also, yeah, I think that's what even we had done. And we had also looked at, you know, how at our climate analysis under this. So I'm not sure if that's right. And, you know, Prasad, you can point it out if I'm saying something wrong over here. But yeah, that's what we did for our context and market analysis.
So I think that there are two or three ways in which to do the context and market analysis. And sometimes they're the same thing, sometimes they're different. So for example, the case that Pradeep mentioned, where there's a team that is proposing bamboo as a solution. And you're all gung-ho about the fact that we are going to have this fantastic bamboo technology in our project. But have you done the context analysis to know whether bamboo is a local material or not? And if you consider it to be a scalable project, then is there enough bamboo available? So the technologies and the materials that are available is part of the context analysis. The thing that you mentioned, Yashima, where your project is a school, so you need to understand the social and demographic situation in that area to know, you know, for example, are only girls going to be coming to the school? Then you should know that. If it's going to be boys and girls together, then you should understand that. You should understand what is the level of fees that they're able to pay. What is the kind of lifestyle that they are used to, so that your design is appropriate for them. And these are some of the examples of what a context and market analysis is. So context analysis is understanding what is around you and what the resources are in general. And the market analysis is understanding who are the people who are demanding this, whatever it is that you are trying to provide. And what is their background? What is their profile?
Right. And also, I would like to add that the previous year reports are there on the website, which have done the context and market analysis in very detail. So you can look at those and, you know, see how, and you see how you could incorporate those factors also in your design. And I think with that, we'll end our session for today. We have around 20 questions still pending, which we'll share it in written on Moodle as a PDF, as we always do. So feel free to look up in maybe 3 to 4 days on Moodle for the answers to your pending questions. Also, as an announcement, I would like to also say that we have shared a cost estimation spreadsheet with your teams. So that is a deliverable, that is a part of your deliverable 3. And it's a sheet which will help you estimate the cost for your project. So, and also we would request you to take a look at that sheet and come back next week, because we will be doing a webinar related to that. And with that, I would like to thank everyone for joining us today. And of course, yes, Prasad.
And I just want to reiterate that all of these people who are on the screen today, there's more of them. There's 53 of them who are available, and they are willing to help you guys out with all these kinds of questions that you may have to the best of their ability. So please do contact them. They are eager and waiting to help you guys, because they've been through the same thing and they know how difficult it is. So, you know, make use of them, and I'm sure that you'll get, you know, something great out of the interaction.
Thank you, Prasad. And thank you everyone for joining and participating. And to all the participants, we'll see you next week.
Yep.
Bye.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
Thank you.
Yep, thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.